There's a place you can get to without any sound. It's a place where the wick has burned out. There's a place at the point that's past turning around. There is a place to be lost long after you're found. There's a land you can reach if you follow yourself. It's a land beyond hoarding your fears so to quell. There's a land where the bottom falls out of the well. There is a land where your worry and wonder can dwell. Coax your quiet questionings. Speak your soft uncertainties. There is room for these in the land of the seeking. Draw a map without borders and see where you go. In the cover of night, call a question a home. Past the edge of the fences, you're never alone. Where your worry and wonder are known. Coax your quiet questionings. Speak your soft uncertainties. There is room for these in the land of the seeking. The compass points straight to the heart. The shadow of a doubt. The key is the most honest thing that you can't speak aloud. There is no wrong way to be unsure of things. There is no wrong way to the land of the seeking. Coax your quiet questioning, speak your soft uncertainties. There is room for thee.
Well, good morning. Good morning. And welcome to worship at Emmanuel High Church from wherever you are for a time of worship this morning. Today is Sunday, March 12th, the third Sunday in Lent, and we are celebrating milestones this morning. This Lent, we've crafted a Lenten series founded on questions. Like the characters in our Lenten scriptures, we are seeking many things: clarity, connection, wonder, and balance. We're seeking our calling, the sacred, and how to live as disciples. We hope that each Lenten Sunday will help us unpack some of the big questions that we have in ways that are honest and faithful. Today, our theme is, "Will you give me a drink?" And during the time of personal prayer, after our communal prayer this morning, and during time of personal prayer and confession, I invite you to take your post-it note out and write on there what you're thirsting for. We've given you a little cover if you don't want everyone to see it. At the end of worship, we'll put them back on the wonder wall that you'll see as you exit in the hallway there. So the question that we're thinking about today during our time of silence is, what is your soul thirsting for? What are you longing for? If you haven't taken the time to look at the questions that are on the wonder wall, there's some interesting things that are posted there by you all from the last couple of weeks. So I encourage you to write on your post-it, add to our wonder wall, and see what's already there. A couple of announcements before we get started. A special thank you to Lillian Kindle for providing our special music during the offertory this morning, and to the Ulmer family for hosting this month's social gathering. We'll be having a gathering, cookies and coffee after worship, so I hope you'll stop back and greet Lillian and tell her what a great job she's done. Also, how many of you guys watched the Girl Chips play last night? Great job all the way to state finals, just a little bit shy of bringing home the gold. So good job to them. Let's see. Lunch and Learn series is continuing on Thursday, the history of the Bible and archaeology. We will be learning the ministry of Jesus and studying the phases of that. So for those of you who haven't been here before, on Thursdays at noon, we have a half-hour video teaching us about the archaeology and history of the Bible. And then we break and we have soup. There's no prep. Just come and learn more about the history of the Bible and then join us for some soup if you're around on Thursdays. Let's see. Oh, Blanket Sunday. Thank you so much on Blanket Sunday. If you haven't heard, we collected $783.31. So that is just a great tribute. Thank you. God is good and you are generous. Let's see. I'll be on vacation on the 23rd through the 29th. David Lohr will be in the pulpit on the 26th. So I hope you'll all show up and welcome him on that day. And I believe that there's an order form for flowers, yes, in your bulletin. Is that true? Okay. So we are starting to fill out orders. If you'd like to order some flowers for Easter, we will be taking orders. You can put them in the offering plate. Also, on Easter morning, we will be having an early service at 9 o'clock with our very own Ernie leading the way, and we will be having breakfast afterwards. If you're coming for breakfast, please sign up, and please check off if you're willing to help serve or cook, sir. All right. A couple of other things. There's other churches that are having activities for Lent, and we'd certainly like to help them out. On Sunday, March 26th, that is, the Wadsworth UCC Church will be having a men's choir sing called the Sonnenberg Station. They're a 16-member men's ensemble. They'll be singing spirituals, sea chanties, and big city gospel. So I hope if you're able, you can attend. It's a free will offering, so there's no admissions. Also, on Wednesdays, Zion Lutheran Church is sponsoring a soup supper at 6 o'clock every Wednesday until Palm Sunday. There's no charge, but donations are, of course, welcome. And there will be a devotion time at 6:45 following the soup dinner. All right. With that, are there any other announcements for the good of the group? All right. Then let's take a moment to prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Each week we do that by placing our right hand on our hearts and our left hand on our bellies, and we just relax and slow down. Let's take a slow cleansing breath through our nose like we're smelling flowers to the count of four. And then let's just exhale through our mouths to the count of more than four. Let's take another cleansing breath in, breathing in God's love and God's light. And then let's just let it out, breathing out any leftover stress or anxiety we might be feeling. We remember that no matter where we are right now, that God is with us, ever drawing us near. Let us open our worship with this poem entitled, "The Answer is Yes," by Reverend Sarah Speed. It's the question we ask at the end of our rope, when the storm is raging, when the monsters under the bed have introduced themselves, when everything around us seems to be on fire, when hope slips through the like sand in a bottle, when the mockingbirds stop singing, when the news reporter leads with another mass shooting. It's the question we ask when the depression moves in, making herself at home, making a mess of it all. It's the question we ask when we're not sure if Easter will come. Will it be Lent forever? Will the sun ever rise? Will this hope lead to something? Finally, can these bones ever live? And the answer is yes. Let us now open our hearts and minds to worship as we bring in the light of Christ and we listen to our prelude. Thank you.
we gather together. We gather together. So come to the well. Come, let us worship God. Amen. Please join me in the opening prayer. Holy God, we have been on every side of this story. We have been the one who is thirsty and in need of compassion, and we have been the one with a bucket and a deep well. So today we wonder, how often have we missed the opportunity to share water with our neighbors? How often have we forgotten that we have a bucket and the power to bring change? How often have we simply decided that justice and compassion were not worth the work? Forgive our fragile hearts and remind us that it was you who sat at that well in Samaria in the heat of the day. It was you. It is still you. With hope we pray. Amen.
So in this time of silent prayer, let us ponder, what is your life thirsting for right now? Write it down on your slip. We could lose the bucket. We could hoard the water for ourselves. We could pretend that we do not see all who are thirsty, and we would still belong to God. This is the good news of the gospel. God's grace is deeper than any well. We are seen, we are loved, and we're forgiven. May this realization change and inspire us. Amen. You may be seated. And now call the children forward for our milestones. You guys come and just sit in the front row. You'll get your front row seat. And I'm going to call Miss Helen up here. Okay. All right. In the book of Joshua, we hear the story about milestones. When the whole nation of Israel had crossed onto the promised land, the Lord said to Joshua, "Choose 12 men from among the people, one from each tribe, and then tell them to take 12 stones from the middle of the Jordan and carry them over with you and put them down over at the place where you stay tonight. In the future, when your children ask you, 'What do these stones mean?' tell them, 'When the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord safely crossed over the Jordan, these stones were placed as a memorial to the people of Israel forever.'" Joshua set up the 12 stones that had been in the middle of the Jordan at the spot where the priests who carried the Ark of the Covenant had stood, and there they are to this day. Joshua marked an important event in the lives of the Israelites, one that they were to remember. They were thankful and joy-filled. A new land awaited them and fresh beginnings, a gift from God. Yes, they celebrated because milestones are to be remembered and honored. Big or little, life flows with each milestone if we recognize them. Noticing them and pausing to honor those times adds zest and color to our daily lives. Milestones are hallowed moments. So today I'm going to invite Miss Helen up here to hand out some of our milestones. To the mic.
We have four milestones. Two, I'm going to ask grandparents to both of the two drivers to stand in and they can give it to them. But the first one, Micah, got to come down. Micah was accepted to the criminal justice program at the Barberton High School, and he's going to enter into that program as a junior, correct, Micah? Junior? A junior. And he's hoping to go into law. So that program will help, and he got accepted into that. I was impressed with my gavel drawing.
Oh, that definitely doesn't know. Thank you. Is it 14 poems? How many poems? 14.
Yeah. Okay. No, 11. 11. Okay. Amanda Cotton has written, is it 11, Amanda? 11 poems that she has had published at the Stewart's Caring Place and published in a book. And then we have two young people that got their driver's license. And I took liberty, instead of doing a milestone for those people, when I became a driver, my mom gave us a visor, the clip that went on our visor that said, "Never drive any faster than your guardian angel can fly." And I think that's a good message. So Carl, if you would come up. Andrew Carhop just got his license. And Karen, if you would come up. Alexa Foster just got her license.
I know you want to give it to him to remind them.
All right, let's pray, shall we? God of our past and our future, you bring us to a new moment on our journey. Our friends before us have reached significant milestones and all of the delight and responsibility that goes with them. As a family of faith, we celebrate with wonder the passage of years in their walk of faith, growing ever closest to you. Lord God, you have called your servants to ventures which we cannot see the ending, by paths yet untrodden, through perils unknown. Give us faith to go out with good courage, not knowing where we go, but only knowing that your hand is leading us and your love supporting us. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Will you join me in our prayer of commitment? Reflecting the light of God's love, we see emerging in you the wonderful person God created you to be. We rejoice in the courage and growth that these milestones represent. May they be more than a private experience. May they be a sign of the community's encouragement that you continue to grow and shine using these new milestones to glorify and serve the Lord. You may be seated. I brought a different song today, friends. Couldn't sing that sea shanty one more time. Let's try it, shall we? And now children may be dismissed with Miss Helen.
Our first lesson today is from Exodus chapter 17, verses 1 through 7. Our first lesson comes from the book of Exodus. Listen now to the word for God's people. From the wilderness of Sin, the whole congregation of the Israelites journeyed by stages as the Lord commanded. They camped at Rephidim, but there was no water for the people to drink. The people quarreled with Moses and said, "Give us water to drink." Moses said to them, "Why do you quarrel with me? Why do you test the Lord?" But the people thirsted there for water. And the people complained against Moses and said, "Why did you bring us out of Egypt to kill us and our children and livestock with thirst?" So Moses cried out to the Lord, "What shall I do with this people? They are almost ready to stone me." The Lord said to Moses, "Go on ahead of the people and take some of the elders of Israel with you. Take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile and go. I will be standing there in front of you on the rock at Horeb. Strike the rock and water will come out of it so that the people may drink." Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. He called the place Massahah and Meribah, because the Israelites quarreled and tested the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" May God bless the reading and hearing of his holy word.
Thank you.
Our gospel lesson this morning comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 4, verses 5 through 29 and 39 through 42. Listen now to the word for God's people. So Jesus came to a Samaritan city called Sychar, near the plot of ground that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired out by his journey, was sitting by the well. It was about noon. A Samaritan woman came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." His disciples had gone to the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask a drink of me, a woman of Samaria? Jews do not share things in common with Samaritans." Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have no bucket, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our ancestor Jacob, who gave us the well, and with his son and his flocks drank from it?" Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again, but those who drink of the water that I will give them will never be thirsty. The water I will give them will become in them a spring of water gushing up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I may never be thirsty or have to keep coming here to draw water." Jesus said to her, "Go, call your husband and come back." The woman answered him, "I have no husband." Jesus said to her, "You are right in saying you have no husband, for you have had five husbands, and the one you have now is not your husband." "What you have said is true," the woman said to him. "Sir, I see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshiped on this mountain, but you say that the place where people must worship is in Jerusalem." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for the Father seeks such as these to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth." The woman said to him, "I know that the Messiah is coming, who is called Christ. When he comes, he will proclaim all things to us." And Jesus said to her, "I am he, the one who is speaking to you." Just then, his disciples came, and they were astonished that he was speaking with a woman. But no one said, "What do you want?" or "Why are you speaking with her?" Then the woman left her water jar and went back to the city. She said to the people, "Come and see a man who told me everything I have ever done. He cannot be the Messiah, can he?" Many Samaritans from that city believed in him because of the woman's testimony. "He told me everything I have ever done." So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with them, and he stayed there 2 days. And many more believed because of his word. They said to the woman, "It is no longer because of what you said that we believe, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is truly the Savior of the world." This is the word for God's people. May God bless all who hear it and who keep it. Will you pray with me? As we prepare now to listen for your message, Lord, open our hearts. And may the words I speak and the message received by all that are gathered here be in accordance with your will for us. Amen. Wow, we heard a lot of scripture this morning, didn't we? But with all that, I want to draw your attention to one verse in particular. I will be focusing this moment on the 14th verse of John's gospel. But those who drink of water that I will give them will never be thirsty. The water that I give them will become in them a spring of water gushing up to eternal life. Have you noticed in our gospel lessons this season, as Jesus now turns to his Lenten journey toward Jerusalem and the cross, that he's already started pointing out to those he's encountered where new life can be found? Not some distant future life after death kind of new life, but the kind of new life that you find right here and right now that can start anytime. Last week, we heard the story of Nicodemus asking how he might be born again. And we discussed how being born again is not a once and done kind of action, but it's one that we need to choose over and over again with every single decision that we make. So it got me wondering, but what happens after we make that first hard step, that first hard choice? Then what happens? Because what happens next after we make that first step out into new life sometimes determines whether we'll continue to step out bravely forward, or whether we're going to run back to the shelter of our old outdated patterns. Well, after answering that question, it didn't take me long to find out the answer this week. I don't know about you, but I've noticed that many of us have become more fearful since the pandemic hit. I know several people who still strictly limit their face-to-face interactions with others. They order their groceries and medications online and then sit in their car and have someone just put them back in their trunk. There are a lot of us limiting ourselves in ways we never knew before, and I must confess now, kind of red-faced, that I also developed a bit of a phobia during the pandemic that I found quite hard to shake once it was over. Let me explain. Before the pandemic, all those years back, I needed a root canal over here. And so I went to a new dentist and he sent me to the endodontist. And when I got there, you know, I've always been a little nervous around dentists and hygienists. Sorry, Nancy. I know she's giving me the thumbs up like I could have done it. But I was nervous. And so I finally went. And instead of getting a root canal, the endodontist simply looked at me and said, "Well, it's cracked. You're going to have to go back and have it pulled." And he sent me back to the dentist, who yanked that tooth out that very day. And then the lockdown hit. And afterwards, every time I thought about going back, I had this knot in my stomach. And every time I'd have that knot in my stomach, I would just somehow put off calling the dentist. And the longer I waited, the more ashamed I felt that somehow my inattention to my dental care was going to result in more teeth extractions and other dire complications. And so each week my anxiety grew, and each week that knot got worse. It wasn't rational, I know, but I've got to believe that some of you sitting out there have some things that make your stomach clench too. And maybe you have a call or two that you've been putting off. So maybe you know what I mean. Well, anyway, the tooth on the other side finally started hurting, and I mustered the courage to finally tell my husband I got a problem. And well, Tom was an operations manager before he became a minister. And so you give him a task and it gets done. And I knew that when I told him, I knew there would be no turning back. And so within a couple of days, I found myself sitting next to Tom in the dentist office in a chair, one hand on my heart and one hand on my belly going, breathe into the count of four, gay, slow, and out to the count of more than four. I was nervous. Finally, the moment came and hygienist Jill stepped out of the office and called me in. The moment had finally come where I had to meet my fate. Jill was amazing. There were no recriminations about the lapse since my last dental appointment as she looked and saw it was 4 years ago. She explained everything carefully, what was about to happen, and then proceeded to professionally, over the next hour and a half, clean my teeth and take my x-rays. And when she was all done, that fear of my dental appointment that had obviously caused me to not come, she said, had made me so diligent that other than the one tooth that was bothering, everything else looked just fine. After all that time of worrying, I came away happy and relieved that I am now drinking from the well of new dental life. Well, things aren't perfect, but as I took that first shaky step, honestly, I was so filled with anxiety. Hygienist Jill gave me that cup of water I needed from the well of living water. One tone of judgment from her, just one look of disdain, one more bad or hurtful experience, and I would have run right back to drink out of that old well of avoidance. I know I would have. Well, you know, we all have to go down some well. For some, it's like the Samaritan woman, it's the marriage well. For others, it's the well of perfectionism. Some go to the well of hiding and isolation, and others will draw from the well of power and control. Too many of us will drink from the wells of addiction. And many of us live, as I do, in the well of busyness and denial. We could each name the wells from which we drink day after day, month after month, sometimes year after year. We go back to that same old well to drink. We arrive hoping our thirst is going to be quenched, and when we leave, we're just as thirsty as when we got there, only to return again the very next day. For too long, we've drunk from the well that never satisfies, the well that, well, can never satisfy. Husband after husband, this is the well to which the Samaritan woman has returned. There is another well, though. It's the well of Jesus Christ. It's the well that washes us clean of our past. This is the well from which new life and new possibilities spring forth. It's the well that frees us from those old habits and patterns that keep us living as thirsty people. It's that well that the Samaritan woman in today's gospel found. She intended to go to the same old well she had gone to for years, the well that her ancestors and their flocks had drunk from. But this day was different. This day, Jesus holds before her two realities of her life: the reality of what is, and then the reality of what her life might be. Jesus is more interested, you see, in her future than in her past. He wants to satisfy her thirst more than judge her for her history. He looks beyond her past and sees a woman sitting in front of him dying of thirst, a woman thirsting to be loved, to be seen, to be accepted, to be included and forgiven and known. Her thirst will never be quenched by the external wells of life, nor will ours. Jesus told us that. He said, everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again, but those who drink of the water that I will give them will never be thirsty. This is the living water, the water of new life and new possibilities and freedom from the past. This living water is Jesus's own life. It became the Samaritan woman, in her a spring of water gushing up to eternal life. She discovered within herself the interior well that had left, and she left her water jar behind, unneeded, because she had now become the well in which Christ's life flows. It's not enough, however, just to hear her story or even to believe her testimony. Until we come to the well ourselves of Christ's life within us. Until that happens, we'll continue to return to the dry wells of our life. We'll continue to live thirsty. We'll continue to live in fear of being found out. So this morning, I wonder, what are the wells you drink from? And how much longer will you carry your water jars? Because there is another well, one that promises life, one by which we're known and we're loved. So this morning, I invite you, come to a new well. Come to the well of Christ's life, Christ's love, and Christ's presence that's already inside you. Come to that well that is Christ himself. And then drink deeply until you become the well of Christ's love. And all God's people said. I invite you to stay seated as we sing, I've Got Peace Like a River.
We are called to live in hope and to share this hope with the world. Let us offer thanks to God for all God has given us by sharing generously of ourselves and of our resources. Through our gifts, may all experience the hope to be found in our life-giving God. Our morning offering will now be received.
Many nights we prayed with no proof anyone could hear. In our hearts a hopeful song we barely understood. Now we are not afraid, although we know there's much to fear. We were moving mountains long before we knew we could. There can be miracles when you believe, though hope is frail. to kill. Who knows what miracles you can achieve when you believe somehow you will. You will when you believe. In this time of fear, when prayers so often proved in vain, hope seemed like a summer bird to swiftly flow away. Yet now I'm standing here with heart so full I can't explain, speaking words and speaking hearts I never thought I'd say. There can be miracles when you believe. Though hope is frail, it's hard to kill.
Please join me in the prayer of dedication. Life-giving God, we offer you ourselves and our resources. Use us and our gifts that we may be water bearers to a world thirsty for love, for meaning, for justice, and for hope. May all your people encounter fullness of life through the love of Christ, which lives within us. Amen.
You may be seated. Let us be in an attitude of prayer. Empathetic God, for some reason, asking for help is just not that easy. We tell ourselves that we'll be a burden to others. We tell ourselves that we should be able to do it all, when in reality, we all need a little help from time to time. Remind us that even Jesus asked for help. He asked the Samaritan woman for a drink. Let that be a holy reminder to us that it's okay for us to ask for help too. Gracious God, we believe deep in our bones that you offer a type of love, belonging, and care that so many people are thirsting for. And yet we rarely talk about our faith with others. Why is that? Flood our spirits with conviction, Lord, that we might have the courage to speak out about our faith, just like the Samaritan woman did. Show us how to be convicted and yet gentle, how to speak and listen all at the same time. Help us to bring your living water to those we now lift to your healing hands. Today we remember Lindsay, Lucy Rich, and the people of East Palestine, Lord, in your mercy. We pray for Laurel, for peace and acceptance in communities, and for Sherry, Lord, in your mercy. We remember Emily, Jill, Paul and Renala, Barb and Mark, Lord, in your mercy. We lift Chuck and Sherry, John, Natalie, McGee, Lord, in your mercy. We remember Chris Formant, Carol Blanner, Jean Grigalunas, and Ralph Leniker, Lord, in your mercy. We lift Bud and Anita, Sally Miner, and Tom and Ellie, Lord, in your mercy. We remember Chris, Barbara, Sue, and Mark Trenta, Lord, in your mercy. And we lift the families of Sue McGee, McBee, and Nancy Wunderlich, Lord, in your mercy. With hope, we ask these things in the name of your Son, the living water, the one who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I'm going to invite you to rise a bit early and join me in our affirmation of faith and then our closing hymn. So let's rise and join together in our affirmation of faith. We believe that a glass of water given to us by a stranger can taste like justice. We believe that honest conversation has the power to change us. We believe that all God's children have a voice and something to say. We believe that Jesus loves the outcast, the ignored, the shamed, the abandoned. We believe in asking questions. We believe in curiosity. We believe in giving people a drink. May we be brave enough to give people a drink. Amen. Together and sing our final hymn, Begin Again. I remind you to join us in the CIC room for fellowship right after worship. And now as you leave this place, may God bless you with seeking, Seek out the hungry. Seek the weary. Seek the good in every person you meet. Seek out the hopeful. Seek the faithful. Seek God in each one of us. And as you seek and as you wonder, may you find what you're looking for. In the name of God, who is our loving God, who is always seeking us, let us now go in peace. Amen.